Hello and welcome to Inside Iraq. I'm Jassim Azzawi. Margaret Hassan, an Irish aid worker, was kidnapped and killed in Baghdad in 2004. To this day, her remains have not been found. Her family expects justice from the ongoing trial of an individual who has claimed knowledge of the kidnapping of Mrs. Hassan. In 2004, the British Embassy in Baghdad refused to deal directly with the kidnappers, citing a long-standing policy decision. Embassy staff were criticized for giving Margaret's husband, Tahsin, the wrong advice. This tragic story makes us stop and wonder and ask the following question. What about the role and responsibility of the politicians who took the decision to launch this war?
Margaret Hassan fell in love with Iraq 35 years ago when she traveled there with her Iraqi husband, Tahsin Ali Hassan.
Margaret has dedicated herself and her life to helping people through her humanitarian work. She is Iraqi and she was born to help the Iraqi people.
She was Dublin-born but held three passports, Irish, British and Iraqi. She stayed in Iraq throughout the war, working as the head of the Iraqi section of CARE International. Hassan was kidnapped in 2004.
And maybe we will die. I will die like Mr. Bigley. Please, please, beg of you, I beg of you, please.
Despite the protests of many Iraqis calling for her release, she was shot dead several weeks later. The case of Margaret Hassan has been back in the news following an Iraqi court decision to allow the right of a retrial to the man previously convicted of involvement in her kidnap and murder.
And now I'm joined on the phone from Cyprus by Michael Jensen, a reporter with the Irish Times who has written extensively on the story of Margaret Hassan. Michael, tell us exactly who are the culprits who kidnapped and killed Margaret Hassan.
Well, Margaret Hassan was seized from her car on October 19, 2004, in Baghdad. The group which claimed to have kidnapped her was called the 20th Revolutionary Brigade. And her body was never found, although this brigade broadcast video of her being killed around the middle of October of 2004. The person who was eventually arrested was Ali Lutfi Jassar al-Rawi. He was an Iraqi engineer, and he was detained in 2008. He was involved in the Hassan case because he tried to extort from the British Embassy in Baghdad $1 million to provide information on where Margaret Hassan was buried. He was tried and sentenced to life in prison, but was granted a retrial this year. Margaret's sisters, who seek justice and repatriation of her remains, recently met British Prime Minister Gordon Brown, who promised full cooperation of the Foreign Office and the embassy in Baghdad in this effort to both get the man committed to prison and also to obtain information on where her body may lie.
Michael Jensen, a reporter with the Irish Times, thank you very much for being a guest on Inside Iraq.
Thank you for inviting me.
And now I'm joined from Galway by Michael D. Higgins, a member of the Irish Parliament who is also Labour Party president and spokesperson of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and by Dennis Halliday, former head of the UN humanitarian program in Iraq from 97 to 98, and from Basel, Switzerland, by Hans von Sponeck, the former UN humanitarian coordinator in Iraq. Gentlemen, welcome to Inside Iraq. Mr. Higgins, let me start with you.
Thank you.
Regarding Margaret Hassan and the kidnapping and her death, it is almost impossible to separate the personal from the political. The backdrop for her kidnapping was the attack on Fallujah. What is your recollection of those days?
Well, I'd met Margaret Hassan on three occasions. The very first time, it was a discussion of a project that she had assisted in relation to the effects of uranium-enriched munitions that had been left on children's health. The second time, very much about, again, it was about sanitation of water, but then finally, about what would happen about the distribution of food to families. This is just about 2 to 3 weeks before the invasion. To answer your question very directly, I believe that it is impossible to separate the context that had been created. Margaret, remember, had spent 30 years in Iraq. She was committed to Iraq, its people, its children. And above all else, it's suffering. And her compassion was great. She probably felt she was safer. But from once the attack on Fallujah had taken place, I think that the small groups competing with each other suddenly found that it's necessary to transfer hostages from one group to another. What I find, I must say two things, as I look at the image of Margaret pleading for her life. The horror, what a horrific thing it was for the Iraqi group to visit this death on such a fine woman. And the other, which is the total neglect of her husband and the failure to assist him in trying to make contact with her during days when it might have helped. I'm speaking about the inept behaviour of the British Foreign Office.
We shall come to that, Mr. Higgins, but before we do that, let me engage Dennis Halliday, who is also an expert on Iraq. He worked there and he knows the country very well. You were not surprised, Mr. Halliday, when she was kidnapped and Iraqis demonstrated in the Ferdows Square, that's the downtown Baghdad, asking for her release, and also demonstration in Ramallah, of all places, because in her youth she also was involved in charity work with the Palestinian cause.
Well, Margaret was an extraordinary person, a beautiful person and a dedicated person with great compassion, as Michael Higgins has just told us. And I met her in 97 and in 98 on several occasions. She came to the UN office for coordination meetings of NGO and other UN inputs into Iraq. So she had she was well known in Iraq, well known amongst ordinary people who saw the work she was doing in the health sector, in sanitation and water. And I went to see those projects with her, and again when we had visits from ITV in London, and again with RT. I mean, she was just very well known. So I was not surprised that the people in Baghdad came out looking for her well-being and trying to find her release. Clearly, she was kidnapped by those who did not care or did not know, and the motive is not understood by me even to today.
Hans von Sponeck, you knew the woman very well also. She was a brave woman. She never cared about what might happen to her, and she sacrificed everything for the sake of the poor people that she wanted to help in Iraq. What is your recollection of Margaret Hassan?
Well, first of all, let me say that in my address book, I have, until today, been unable to cross out her name. Because for me, it is still incomprehensible that such a beautiful, such a powerful, such a dedicated person, a European by birth maybe, but an Iraqi at heart, could be taken away from us so cruelly. I remember Margaret Hassan from innumerable meetings in our office in the Canal Hotel in Baghdad, but also in her office. Her office was a small command center, a strong woman with a small staff that tried to add to the Oil for Food program a small but very important projects in education, in water supply, and in health. And we would sit together over a cup of tea in her office to try to develop what to her was so important, and that is to protect people as much as she could with CARE International funds, supplementing what we in the UN were doing at a large and national scale. She struck me as a woman with an immense sense of compassion for a people, a whole nation that was brought down by, we can say it easily today, by a faulty international sanction policy. So we would talk, and I remember very vividly one occasion when she remarked how humiliating it had been that qualified, highly trained Iraqi doctors, engineers, pilots had become vendors on the streets, were selling cigarettes and maybe chewing gum. And what she looked at me and she said, and you know, A few days ago, I went to the market with someone to eat an ice cream. And when I had the ice cream in my hand, I looked at the man and I recognized him as a medical doctor whom I had known. So she was extremely sensitive to the humiliation to which the Iraqi people were subjected. And this is what I remember so well.
She was a remarkable woman indeed. She was born in Dublin, and then she was raised in England, and she married an Iraqi engineer, Mr. Tahsin Hassan. And she lived many, many years in Iraq. And in the 90s and up to the war, she was involved with charity work. But let me go back to you, Michael D. Higgins. You said something important about the ineptness of the British embassy in Baghdad in dealing with this.
Yes.
Exactly what do you mean?
Well, what I mean by this is that I think that Tahsin was left very much on his own. I've read the comments of Margaret's sisters. I've met Margaret's sisters. And I've discussed this. And I was involved myself when they visited Dublin and met the Taoiseach, met the Irish Prime Minister and ministers. And I got the impression that people were managing a kidnapping in a public relations sense. And then I was quite horrified to hear that there had been telephone calls made on Margaret's phone to her husband, Tahsin. And I visualized this poor man in his apartment on his own without assistance. And then the suggestion, well, we would have to verify that these calls were coming from those who held her and so forth. Now, Margaret's kidnapping had been preceded by Kin Bigley's kidnapping. And I had met a brother of Kin Bigley's, and we had made calls and different groups who might have information and whatever. And I could see, and I know today how important it was to act very quickly. I make that point, and that's why I make it. The second one which I want to emphasize, lest I forget it, is that I believe that there is an obligation on every form of Iraqi government to solve this issue of the whereabouts of Margaret's body, and also to remove any suggestion of impunities from those who have been involved in her abduction and her killing, whoever they may be and however well connected they may be. And it's in that sense that, in a way, what I remember about this woman talking to me about the adequacy of diet during the Oil for Food program, the whole question of the treatment of children and whatever, the idea that her body is still not with her family is simply just incredible. I can barely bear myself to look at the images that have been put into print as she pleads for her life.
Indeed, I had spoken with two of the sisters of Margaret, and the only thing they want right now is justice for her death and kidnapping, as well as for her remains to be returned, to be buried, and given a decent Christian burial, as she lived a very strict Catholic life to her last dying day, Dennis Holliday.
Yes.
Regarding the British embassy and the way dealt with it and the advice they give to Mr. Tahsin Hassan, and that is to emphasize to the kidnappers her Iraqiness, that is to say that she was a holder of three passports, an Irish, a British, an Iraqi passport.
Yeah.
With the benefit of hindsight, Mr. Dennis Holliday, would you think that was perhaps the best advice the embassy could give Mr. Tahsin?
Well, you know, I really don't understand what went wrong, because clearly, whether it's the British or the Iraqi government of the time, this was badly handled and somebody's life was lost. I know the link to Fallujah. This morning, I called a friend in Baghdad who confirmed, of course, the Fallujah connection and believes that she was killed in Fallujah. And as we know, the Fallujah, the attack by the Americans was an atrocity, a genocidal atrocity on the people of Fallujah, which can never be forgotten. It's a war crime that should be continued.
Yeah.
And a tragedy. Yeah. And the need for revenge, the anger on the part of good, decent Iraqis was very real. But of course, Margaret was taken, in my view, by those who did not belong in Iraq. They were undoubtedly not Iraqi. Whereas you said earlier, Jassim, she had huge support. She was very well known. Her work was well known. She, like all of us, she appeared on local television linked to her project work. And I visited these extraordinary new clinics that she was constructing with very little money, believe me.
Yes.
And as Hans said, you know, we worked with her, we added to her projects, we had bigger resources. But she made a unique played a unique part in Baghdad, in Basra, other parts of the country, doing things that we couldn't do.
Let me just emphasize that point. Of all people who called for release was the leader of Al-Qaeda in Iraq, Abu al-Mus'ab al-Zarqawi, who distanced himself from the kidnapping of Margaret Hassan and demanded, he asked, whoever is kidnapping Margaret Hassan should be released. That was the measure,
yes,
and that was the stature of Margaret Hassan.
That's
but
right.
Hans von Sponeck, when we talk at the individual and we talk about a large number of people who are killed, I'm almost reminded by what Stalin said about the death of an individual. He said that would be a tragedy, while the death of millions is just a statistics. Today we are discussing Margaret Hassan not only because she is a remarkable woman, but there are many, many remarkable people in Iraq who got killed, over a million people,
yes,
and they are forgotten.
I would submit that Margaret Hassan, to me at least, has become a symbol of all those who resisted the faulty policies in Baghdad by the government there, but equally so the faulty policies, the devastatingly faulty policies of the United Nations Security Council. So she is, to me today, standing in for all those who lost their lives, who had the courage to speak out, who resisted both national and international policies as long as they were not in the interest of the people of Iraq. And in that sense, we can link Margaret Hassan to the thousands, to the hundreds of thousands that have lost their life, particularly since 2003, since the invasion. And that is, to me, what motivates me to carry on, to keep in mind and respect by what I'm doing, respect what Margaret Hassan, in her way, tried to do before she was so brutally murdered.
When we decided to do this story, Michael D. Higgins, I was told about a film of her death, blindfolded and shot on the back of her head with a 22 caliber gun. I decided, and many, like millions of other people, not to see it. But although somebody had pulled that trigger, but actually the war itself, the 2003 war, somebody else pulled this trigger. I can think of two individuals, President Bush and Prime Minister Blair, are behind the death somehow of Margaret Hassan.
Well, I remember when I met Margaret Hassan first, and I was there just around the time of the invasion of Kuwait. And I met many professionals in Iraq. And then later, during the middle of the oil for food and the sanctions, particularly, and I heard somebody earlier, as was mentioned earlier, in visiting the souk and seeing intellectuals and professors selling their books, the interior decorated doors of their houses. What was going on was humiliation and degradation and the devastation of a people that should never be forgotten and never be forgiven. And in the creation of that context of not only the invasion but the humiliation and degradation of an ancient culture and its people, the people responsible for that were creating the context that led to these dreadful people taking this magnificent woman and humiliating her and treating her in this appalling, appalling way. In relation to Mr. Bush and Mr. Blair, yes, yes, of course, they are complicit in these awful events, and they should be remembered for it.
Dennis Holliday?
Yes, well, the fact is that George Bush and Tony Blair are both war criminals. They should be prosecuted, if not by the United Nations, they should be prosecuted at home in Washington and in London. I mean, they have taken their respective countries to war. They attacked an innocent population, yeah, of some 20, 25 million people, having already slaughtered over a million under the sanctions regime, which they dominated and pursued in the Security Council. They then proceeded to massacre possibly another million, creating something like 2 million displaced people within the country and another 3 or so million outside the country as refugees. Iraq is now a country that is destroyed. It is a massacre. It's genocidal. And the cultural damage, the damage to infrastructure, the damage to the lives of so many millions of Iraqis is absolutely unacceptable. And these two men, above all others, should take responsibility, and for the United Nations, the Security Council, to fail to prosecute, given the fact that their countries obviously have failed to prosecute, is a gross injustice. And it does nothing to say to the decency, the humanitarian love, affection, the life that Margaret Hassan gave to the people of Iraq. We have an atrocity. We have no response to it from the Americans nor the British.
Hans von Sponeck, you are not an Irishman like Mr. Halliday, Mr. Higgins, but you also served in Iraq. Now, regarding the responsibility of the current British government, Mr. Brown, the Prime Minister, met with one of the sisters of Margaret Hassan during the Chilcot inquiry and promised help to the sisters regarding the remains of Margaret Hassan. Exactly what is the obligation of the British government towards the family now should be?
I would say the British government, of course, must first of all pursue this question of who is the culprit. It mustn't be, Mr. Higgins rightly said, it must be the government of Iraq, but it must also be the British government and it must be the United Nations. This whole question of individual compensation, how can one compensate anyway for the life of Margaret Hassan? One cannot, but one can pursue this. One can look for accountability. As Dennis Halliday said, the Security Council should not meet, have a faulty policy with very serious implications, and ultimately be free, get free. So it is about Mr. Bush. It is about Tony Blair. It's also about Mr. Aznar and Mr. Berlusconi and about lesser evil people. But it is also about the question of accountability of the entire United Nations Security Council. And no
yes.
one, neither Mr. Brown nor Mr. Obama, are willing to touch that subject of accountability, which would invariably again involve these two governments.
This is a last question to Mr. Higgins and Mr. Dennis Halliday. I'll get two quick responses. Mr. Higgins, this tragedy shouldn't have happened, should it?
It should not have happened. This tragedy was avoidable. The war should not have happened, and the loss of this woman's, wonderful woman's life should not have been happened. And I believe with a real commitment, perhaps could have been avoided. But most of all now, to allow the most minimum closure for her family. Her body must be recovered, but in addition to that, there must be an unremitting pursuit of justice to those who committed the murder. But also in addition to that, I do agree with everything that has been said, that we cannot have leaders of governments acting with impunity with such devastating results.
Mr. Halliday, people will remember Margaret Hassan for years to come.
They certainly will. I think when things settle down in Baghdad, when they kick out the Americans and get rid of the British and the EU presence, this country will revert to civilization again. And I should hope that Margaret will have a street, a boulevard, a statue in her name and in her presence. She made a huge contribution, the sort of contribution that all of us like to make in life, but of course it's so difficult to do so. But she gave everything, her happiness and her future and her work to the children, the people, the women of Iraq through her work in that sector of health and care.
Dennis Halliday, Hans von Sponeck, Michael D. Higgins, gentlemen, thank you for being guests on Inside Iraq.
Thank you.
All the best.
To watch the show online, please visit our website, aljazeera.net/English. We have reached the end of this show. Join me next week when we take another look inside Iraq. Until then, this is Jassim Azzawi wishing you a great week.